Welcome everyone. I am Bart Verhagen. I'm a computer vision engineer at Kopernikov. Basically, we make data and custom data and computer vision applications and solutions for industrial customers. So we're mainly busy with embedded systems, but more like the high end, the fast stuff, not the small 8-bit embedded applications. But still, tonight is really about C++ in all those kind of embedded devices, and certainly not only limited to those high-end ones. Perhaps first a quick survey. So if you're developing for embedded applications, what is the main language that you're now developing in? For who is it C? Okay, so that's quite a lot of people. Anyone C++ as the main language? Okay, so any other ones? Rust or okay?
Alba.
Any?
Alba.
Yeah. Okay. Bash, perhaps some on some portals. No. Okay. Great. So so you're slight different from the non-official numbers. I cannot really find any official numbers for embedded applications specifically. But if you look at non-official ones, then most sources speak about that almost all embedded applications are written in either C or C++, and that the amount of that is written in C is about 2/3, and about 1/3 in C++. So let's take a look at how it all began. So it's in the 60s, and Dennis Ritchie basically came up with his book, The C Programming Language, which was basically the point at which C was made public and easy and free to use for everyone. So back in the days, C was actually like really the first systems programming language that was used quite a lot around the world. And so it was actually quite convenient because, well, we were finally done with writing assembler itself. It mapped rather well at the time to the assembler instructions. If you're using a mental model today of the CPU, typically it still maps rather well to it. We had rather good control over everything, so performance-wise you didn't lose that much. And it was, back at the time, it was quite portable because you're writing this in the special language and you compile it to your target platform. This was quite nice, and so C conquered the world rather quickly. But at the same time, mainly in academics, there were other programming paradigms that started to arise and where everyone was experimenting with. And one of those stronger paradigms, or more dominant paradigms, was actually what is now the predecessor of object-oriented programming. And so the tech giants back then, so Dennis Ritchie came from Bell Labs, but think about IBM and even Philips at the time. They all started to basically create their own custom superset on top of C, implementing those paradigms. And then Bell Labs, once a colleague actually of Dennis Ritchie, well, not really a colleague, but the same company, Bjarne Stroustrup, he basically started making C with classes, as it was originally called, and later on C++. He really liked the paradigms that he found in a Simula 67. And what he basically did is he took C because it had a large user base with a familiar syntax, and he tried to add the paradigms he knew from Simula 67 to put them on top of it. Then those tech giants at the time had all their competing ones, but then Bell Labs did something similar as for C, and at the time it was really quite remarkable and special, which is that once again in 1972, Bjarne Stroustrup was allowed to write the C++ programming language, the first edition, but I didn't find a picture of that one, where he once again he basically made the C++ language public and free to use for everyone. So this is the point where they say C++ was invented, but it was actually already used at Bell Labs a few years before that. Ever since C++ actually came out, it was all prophesied that it would take over C because it was just this superset of C, so just with extra functionality. But somehow it didn't really do it, right? In certain areas, it quite successfully took over. A lot of these areas were taken over by actually higher level programming languages in the meantime. And but still, this prophecy of C++, which would get away rid of C, it kept hanging there, but the language wasn't going too well. That was actually until 2011, when they actually released a new C++ standard, the C++11. And that finally, at 2011, it basically brought C++ into the 21st century. So it was the first major revision of C++ since basically 72. There were some additions, like very important ones, a couple of them, but still, they considered to be the really first major new standard release of the C++. And at this time, the C++ Standard Committee, they really professionalized, so they made different working groups, and now they're actually releasing C++ at a space of like a new standard revision every 3 years. They intertwine major and minor releases, so it's not that you really, every 3 years, you have to learn a completely different language. And C++ 17 was supposed to be a major one, but it kind of became a minor one, actually. But still, it is in there. So at this point, in the standard committee, they actually started to really focus on certain groups. And one of those groups was really embedded systems. So from C++ 11, forget a bit of the myths of long before that actually were there. In C++ 11, they finally tried to make it work and to get rid of those. And once again, now everyone's saying C++ will take over C again. We'll see. I'll try to convince you today at least to consider it for your application. And my main message here is to really see when you to use C++ and when not to use C++, and to be able that if you are already using C++, what kind of things you can use in embedded applications with the newer standards. The most C++ is a superset of C. The most important features it adds on C++ is often thought as object-oriented programming, as I described, and also compile-time programming. So that's the two areas we're mainly going to focus on tonight. So basically, if I want to prove that you should use C++ for your application instead of C, I think there are four areas of interest here. And in order to be better, you need to be actually at least as good as language B for all of the areas, and preferably in one or more even better. So there, first of all, we have like runtime performance. So that's the CPU performance, also memory performance. But with an embedded public key, let's also put the binary size, which is rather important for really small embedded applications, also below this area for a moment. Then there's, of course, safety and security risks, also very important for embedded systems because, well, they're basically out there. More and more you actually get external access to it, but that's still not always the case. And those things, they just need to run. They're often used for performance critical and just safety critical features. So also that is rather important. Thirdly, that's a thing, especially for us, also for our company, of course, is basically to develop fast and without having all the safety and security risks. And yeah, well, maintenance costs, maintenance is quite often overlooked despite being the biggest cost quite often there is in a project. But yeah, it's also definitely important. And before I really want to start on my comparison, I first want to level the playing field, actually, because when I start talking to C people about C++, they immediately come out and they start comparing C++ like it's huge and slow and all that kind of things. And they basically compare the C++ feature set, the complete feature set, with just C, plain and simple as it is. And I think that is not an entirely fair observation in this case for comparison, basically because of a principle, the zero overhead principle, that has been actually in C++ from the start. In contrast with what most people think, the zero overhead principle does not mean that C++ runs without overhead. There's no programming language I know of that actually runs completely without zero overhead. Okay. But what it actually means is basically that if you don't use it, then you don't pay any overhead for it. And this principle, they applied it rather well in C++. So it's not for the full 100%, but most of the time, they stick to this principle, and even today when they are developing new standards, it's also one of the more important principles that will stand out there. This has a couple of important complications actually on it. First of all, it basically means that if we switch, if we take a C++ program or C++ compiler and we switch off all features from C++, we should basically end up again with C, right? So yeah, it's a bit useless, but at the same time, it also means that we see that there's quite a common ground there. And this also implies basically that there should be some fine-grained control over what features you do and do not use in C++. And so as a developer, you can quite tightly control what you want to use and what you don't want to use. Finally, there's also an ecosystem around C++ that actually allows you the tools to check for that kind of things. We've been waiting quite a long time for that as well, actually. And so just to illustrate this kind of principle, I took one of the runtime parameters, in this case binary size, to show. So basically, I have what is the simplest C program I could find. I basically run them through both a C compiler and a C++ compiler. Note that I link them statically, and I also asked to do just default stripping there is by GCC. And as you can see, direct the binary size is actually quite comparable. So the code in it will also be rather similar. And so far, everything looks fine. Unfortunately, when you start, if you would start writing C++, you are of course going to try to use the C++ standard library, hopefully, and not just plain C, and start using at least useful features that are in there. And so I also tried the same with the Hello World in the C style and the default C++ style, and suddenly we actually see quite a big difference. So it's about a 10 megabyte difference on a binary size that is about 6 megabyte for the C and like 17 megabyte for the C++. So suddenly it's quite considerable. The reason actually why there is quite a difference here and why this might already block out a couple of embedded applications is the fact that the C++ standard library is already using itself a couple of features from C++, and as such it is of course linked in the library. Here we take the entire library with us, and as a result it's quite big. But at least theoretically, we could actually end up with a smaller one, because in the C++ case it actually knows more already than in the printf case, because in the printf case it quite often it just needs to parse it searching for the identifier, while in the C++ case we work with streaming operators and it knows it is just a plain old string there. Similar to C, there are a couple of ways in C++ that you can also further lower actually the binary size, like using uclibc. There's also a uclibc++, but it's definitely less mature than uclibc. And then I guess I also have to talk about the elephant in the room here. And that's basically the application binary interface, or ABI for short. So if we go back to C, we see that we were in a world with that came from assembler. They started writing C. Of course, there were already compiler vendors, but it was still quite an open battle. And what they basically did is, C as a simple language, they basically stole each other's API. And so as a result, today C has a standardized ABI, but it's mainly an historical coincidence. Of course, now we see it as one of the features, and so I doubt it will ever change anymore, but it was more of an historical coincidence. When C++ entered the market, it's about a decade later, the things had changed quite drastically. So suddenly compilers are actually competing for market share. C++ is also a much more complex language because the typing system is much more extensive. And as a result, they actually started to invent their own ABI. So as a result, libraries from different C++ compilers are actually not compatible. You cannot expect them to be compatible. They may or may not be. is this a problem? It's quite often named as a problem. But if I look in practice, it's not that much big of a problem quite often, because first of all, who of you already was looking for bugs that ultimately became because of a different compiler flags in libraries or something? I see a couple of hands. There are quite some nasty bugs to find. I myself were also finding found a couple of bugs like that. And so if you really want to be 100% safe and avoid all these kind of things in your embedded system, then you basically have to compile a lot from source and compile everything with the same compiler anyway. And secondly, or at least on Linux, you have the the Clang++ and the G++ compiler, and they basically have a similar application binary interface. I never had actually issues with intertwining them, and I intertwine them quite a lot actually. I actually run more into problems with the fact that G++ changed its ABI before version 5 and after it, and really between G++ and Clang++. On Windows, it's a different story. There, people are actually already quite used to matching the exact compiler through their whole chain. So yeah, for some reason they're used to it, just simply because they have to be. But also, here in this respect, Windows is also not really a problem, because, well, for over a decade, everyone who is actually writing C for a Windows target, Porthole, he or she is already using the Microsoft C++ compiler, because Microsoft has neglected the C compiler for now decades probably, and so they are already using the C++ compiler there. And then finally, there's also still another solution if ABI is important, and that's basically that there's an extern keyword with, and if you give it C as a parameter, then it will basically try to for all the functions and variables in scope, it will use the C ABI. Of course, you can only use the C features there. And I see that this is used actually quite often by, for example, hardware vendors and that kind of people. So I think it makes sense, this kind of interface, if you have like a small interface in comparison with all the features that are beneath the surface in the library. Of course, if you expose basically your entire library, then it probably doesn't make sense to do this. Now, when we take a look at the development time in C++, then I think at least my main ally when I'm trying to write an interface is really the typing system. So I really like it that it's really strong typed. It's like my safety net when I try to make an interface. When my types can forbid you from doing stuff, well, then you simply cannot do it unless you start doing strange things, and then I think you're on your own. So the nice thing about C++ is the type system is more extensive, and that means that you can say more with the same types and with the same interface. What's more, the object-oriented paradigm. I'm not saying it's the only paradigm that exists or that you always should use the paradigm, but it is a useful paradigm. And one of its nice features as well is actually that you kind of get like just a combination or just interfaces is actually documented rather clearly by all having all functions there that are tied together with the object or nicely there in the same spot. Although, yeah, they're nicely there in the same spot instead of being just disjunct functions that happen to together implement an interface. Perhaps for everyone who's not used to the templates, so that's basically the compile time mechanism there is in C++ next to macros. And so the notation might be quite strange for people that are used to C, but basically a template, what it means is it is a template for the compiler to actually generate a class. So let's for a moment cut a corner here and just say that for every real type, it basically will create a class and will replace real type by the actual type you pass in. So in this case a double, and this way you get everywhere a double and you basically get a type safe interface. Important to note here is though that for every combination of types you put in for a template, the compiler will generate a completely different class, and for the compiler it will treat it as a completely disjunct class from another class from another class generated with the same template but a different type. And when I'm talking about expressive interfaces, this actually allows quite some nice things. For example, like here. So basically, here you basically annotate your parameter, saying that it cannot be null. So we still have a pointer here, and we're basically documenting here in code. The compiler can check it and even enforce it in certain cases, not always, that you're actually passing in a null pointer, and you will get actually a compiler error. So if we're talking about self-documenting code, this is actually quite nice. And similarly, you also have like the GSL owner over there, which basically means that you transfer ownership of the int you created to the caller in this case. When we in C++11 actually also introduced a default and deleted keyword. The default basically can give you a default implementation for very specific cases. More importantly, typically, is actually the delete implementation, which basically disallows this operation. So C++, it tries to do a lot basically behind the surface, like creating a copy constructor for copying an object or the copy assignment. But sometimes you don't want it to be copied. Typically, if you're managing resources, any kind of resource, so memory on the heap, but also a file or a socket, then you basically by using isDelete, you can not copy it. So, and once again, you get a compiler error when you do try to copy assign it or to copy it. And that basically brings us to one of the other principles or features of C++ that is quite often quoted, which is basically costless abstractions. So costless abstractions is really what I guess the object-oriented paradigm and a lot of paradigms of C++ are about. So we're trying to abstract things away, but at the same time try not to get the overhead that are typically coming with abstractions. And for this, I actually brought an example with me from Scott Myers. So basically, what you see here on top is basically, let's call it the C-style stack for a moment. So it's basically using C generics in the sense that we use a void pointer. I know it's still a class around it, which is not C. But basically, if you want to make a generic stack in C, that's more or less the kind of signature that you would give it. Then below, we have like the generic implementation of how how you would do it in C++. So once you give it a specific kind of type, and then it basically replaces everywhere. The nice thing about this is that it's actually type safe, in contrast with the C style, where you have to cast things around and hope you cast it to the right value. The disadvantage here is actually, as I said, because for every new type you generate a new new stack class, and so you can get a code bloat. Now, Scott Myers actually came up with a way that we have the best of both worlds. So we have n type safety, and we have also only one really real stack implementation, simply by basically casting it within the wrapper. And any decent compiler, even the older ones, will probably optimize this away. And so what you get is a type-safe interface that is really at the speed of what you're used to with a C-style stack. Another costless abstraction, which on its own I think is already reason enough to actually switch to C++, is a resource acquisition initialization, or RAII. This technique, it's quite default and standard today for people that program with object-oriented languages, but it took actually quite some decades before someone really came up with it, that in this way you can actually start managing resources. So it's very simple, but at the same time it's very strong. So what it does it is basically you write a wrapper that manages one resource, exactly one, no more. You basically acquire the resource when you initialize the wrapper. I kind of have different forms for this. This one doesn't make sense. I think, depending on your resource, this one makes sense or this one, but I put them both here for reference. So that's where you initialize it, and you will basically release the resource once again when the object or the wrapper goes out of scope. So it has a couple of advantages. First of all, it's very safe. You should hardly ever leak, especially when we start going into exceptions that can be thrown. Not a problem in C, but it is in C++. It gets actually very difficult to really have all to get all the routes and to always clean up everything properly if you do it manually. By doing it with this wrapper, it is actually basically the compiler that does the heavy lifting for you. It's also very deterministic. Because initialization of all these kinds of things, it's quite tightly defined in C++, and so when you rerun a program, you will basically get the same behavior. And so if you are looking for bugs, you can more easily find them. That in contrast with garbage collected languages, where the garbage collector can kick in any time and do the craziest things in between when you get out. And what's even better about this is garbage collectors, they, at least in the past, they basically only managed memory, while with this simple paradigm you can manage all kind of resources. So not only memory on the heap, but also files, once again, sockets, pipes, that kind of things. And yeah, once again, it's also a costless abstraction, because once again a smart compiler should automatically figure this out in line and then do all the things you would expect it to do when you would write it manually. In fact, RAII is so often used actually for memory, that's why garbage collected languages are so popular these days, is for managing memory. And so in C++, you actually have smart pointers that do exactly that. So you don't have to write your own RAII wrapper around it. They basically have a unique pointer that is really just for if ownership is very clearly defined, and then there's basically no overhead in comparison with doing it yourself, only much more safety in cleaning it up. And a shared pointer is if you really want to share it among multiple objects. There are a couple of corner cases where this can still go wrong and you can still leak a couple of things. I'm not going to go into that too much, but if you're interested, we can talk about it during the break. But basically, it means that you should use make unique and make shared instead of using the constructor calls directly, and then you should be fine. Another nice feature about C++ is actually when we look into error handling. So one of the, most important issues you quite often find are source of bugs in C languages is that someone forgets to check the return type. Because if it's an error, for example, and you're not checking for the error, then all things can go wrong and the craziest things can happen. In C++ 17, they actually introduced no discard for that reason. And basically, it really gives the compiler a reason that if you simply discard the value without doing anything with it, not assigning it or anything, the compiler is encouraged to actually display a warning. And so, of course, everyone here uses warnings as errors, right? So that means you will get an error if you use it when you try to discard this kind of error return values. In C++, you have a different way of error handling, one that is much hated by a lot of C developers, being the exceptions. Now, exceptions is a bit of a double-edged sword, in the sense that, there's a plus side that you actually cannot ignore an exception. You can ignore an error return value, but you cannot ignore exceptions. On the other hand, anyone can throw exceptions, and if you don't catch them, then your program can crash and that kind of things. And the myth is basically that it's actually slow. So which is why a lot of C people say, or even in C++, a lot of developers even say, we don't use exceptions, we just use the return values. unfortunately, in the meantime, actually, compilers have improved quite a lot. And so these days, compilers are actually able that in the case that it doesn't throw, to actually create a code or assembler that is as fast as if you don't use exceptions. The trade-off, however, is that if you do throw, the program becomes terribly slow and all performance is gone. But yeah, depending on your application, this is a problem or is not, because typically if an error or if an exception occurs, there's an exceptional situation. Typically, you cannot do or continue with a part of your execution anyway. So that's a trade-off that they basically made, the compiler vendors, and it's quite a good one, actually, as long as you use it for exceptional cases. So I've also seen people use it for control flow, but not a good idea if you want to have a fast application. Then if we go look further at optimization, there we see that today compilers, they are so clever actually, and they typically outperform humans. That's as a first stage of optimization, I often say that there's actually an additional step, a very important step there, and that is basically that you try to leverage the compiler on doing the optimization for you, and you do it by giving it as much of the information as possible. By giving it more information, you have the odds are higher that the compiler will actually generate more efficient code. And yeah, in theory at least, the worst case is that it generates the same code as before. But yeah, it's a bit of a numbers game, of course, and statistics. But the nicer plus on this is actually that while you're actually giving the compiler more information, you're also giving you in 6 months or your fellow developers more information, which is also quite nice and then a surplus. So by using this first step and seeing whether you get to the performance you desire, you're actually avoiding the trade-off that there typically is between optimization and readability and abstractions and all of that. And so we have to, if we look at the hello world again, I was talking before about the binary size that theoretically at least could be smaller in C++. The same is true here actually. So because here in C++, we already know the type that we want to print. In theory, at least, the compiler has more information because it knows already the type. And so it should be able to actually generate faster code. Here in the C case, it still has to parse all string to find the identifier, and then it has to, and it only has figured out what ARC-C is about. Of course, this is such a common paradigm, and that I doubt you will actually measure any difference at all, or that C might still be faster, but the idea is still more information means a chance on faster code. Then another nice thing is actually, so the C++ standard committee, they or at least a couple of their members, they really focus on embedded systems, and their main contributions has been actually in compile time optimization. And so you use a template language for it, which is already much more convenient than writing macros in it. And so if we, in this case, I try to get a Fibonacci number of 40. And if you actually look at the assembler, I'm not sure it is clear, but if you go to the link, you actually should find the exact one. Then you will see here, I think, that the number that is returned is exactly the right number for the 40th Fibonacci number. And this is something that you in C you typically will do at runtime or with some very complicated macros, typically. Another myth about C++ is actually that it's very enthusiastically copying objects all around. It actually has the same behavior as C in this regard, because we start to abstract things and we start to get to put objects as member variables in other classes and so forth. The problem is much worse in C++ than in C. Once again, in C++ 11 and onwards, they actually created move semantics, which basically which basically, instead of copying, basically the one that is get moved, it just grabs away the contents of the other object. And so instead of having to copy it around and deleting the other one, it just takes it. Depending on your type, it may or may not actually still be copying or not. It really depends on the on your case. And then there's also the other myth about C++, which I want to tackle, and that is basically that that virtual function calls, they are supposed to be slow, or that's what everyone says. Let's look into more in depth in actually what happens and see what we can conclude from there, right? So how does vtables, the mechanism behind virtual function calls actually work? Well, when you construct your object, basically you have your member variables there, and then the constructor is always specific, so it knows what type it is. It basically also puts a pointer in front of it that basically points to the vtable. This is the vtable, these are different vtables, and so this is the vtable of the type that was actually created, and it will actually point to the start of it. Because it also knows the offset of the function you're calling, it can basically just find the actual function in the vtable, and then it will basically just call the actual function. So if you would compare this with a normal function call, then you basically have this one indirection here, and this one is then basically the same as if you would do it directly. So what we see here, it's only the cost of using a virtual function call is only one redirection. So is that fast? Is it slow? Well, it's hard to say actually, because if all of this is really in cache, then it is actually very fast. So if the one redirection is typically one cycle, if you would compare this with a C implementation that would try to do the same, then you probably will also quickly are wasting at least one cycle for it. So in that regard, it's quite fast. However, if parts of it are not in cache, things become much more complex. First of all, because you're using more pointers that are pointing anywhere and going anywhere, the processor actually has a much harder time to predict what of the instruction cache you are going to access. And that's why it's going to have a much harder time prefetching it. And so statistically, it means that sometimes it may guess wrong. And that means you have a memory stall, and suddenly the virtual function call is actually rather slow. If it's not in even if it's not in cache, the vtables are on a separate part, then the odds are just higher that it's not in cache, so you may get a memory stall there. But still, if you would compare this with the C implementation, then it depends on your application whether or not it actually makes a change there, or it makes it's the difference. All I can say is that the compiler people, they're quite smart people actually, and they typically like to go fast. So typically it is very hard to actually beat them. But it's C++, and that means if you go a little bit more advanced, there are actually workarounds for if you're still saying that virtual function calls are way too slow. And the first of one of that is, basically we call this a static polymorphism. And an easy one is, it only works basically if you have only one subclass that you use, for example, in production. It's a use case that occurs quite often, because typically you want, for example, to mock it in testing, but in your production you know from look, we're always calling this one subclass. We want to have a costless abstraction on top to actually change things, but in practice we only have the one. Then we can basically use a template that is basically a wrapper around it. And if we use like a using, which is basically just a fancy type def, then we basically can use the interface class cookie instead of the chocolate cookie everywhere. And then at a point in time where we want to change the subclass, we basically change the type def, and everything should still work, and it should be okay. We kind of lose a bit of the safety net of the compiler here, because we're not actually implementing an interface anymore. But at the same time, if the function is not there, for all the functions that you actually use, the compiler will try to resolve them. If they're not there, you will of course get compiler errors. This only works if there's one child class in practice. If that's not sufficient, then you can actually go to static polymorphism. It's a paradigm in which we basically where we basically inherit from Bayes, and where the Bayes is actually mimicking the V-table lookup, but this time at compile time. And once again, we basically still have an extra redirection, but it should be optimized out by the compiler. Of course, once again, this only works if you know all those things at compile time and not at runtime. So static polymorphism, it's there, the techniques are there. You see that there are more advanced stuff, so only use them if you really need them to. So that's a bit the thing about C++. You can have high-level tools are at your disposal. The C++ standards committee is really working on them, even making them higher level. And only at the points where you really care about it, you can actually go very deep, almost to the bare metal, as I always say. But yes, basically, you can go up to the assembler language, similar to how you can do that in C. That's where we basically can conclude on C++. So a first message I want to give is that a lot of people in C, they kind of try to reinvent the wheel by using the feature, because they only use this one feature and they don't need all the other features in C++. But as I said, you can basically switch off a lot of them, and the C++ community, they're quite smart people, so they typically do it better than you do it yourself. If you can beat them, that typically means that either you're less generic, you haven't found any corner cases or bugs that it can occur in, or it's just very application specific. And then, of course, there are some caveats in C++ as well. So as I have shown you, I'm a bit short on time in a sense to explain it all here, but there are a lot of things you need to know when you start using these advanced C++. Like example, as I explained, these templates, they look quite nice and they're supposed to be fast, but at the point that you're creating a lot of them, you're basically bloating your code, and suddenly you're actually you have a much slower program instead of a faster one. So you really need to know what you're doing. I hope that on the parts where it matters, you actually also know what you're doing in C. So while it is more difficult there, I think, yeah, for the parts that matter, you should just know what you're doing anyway. Other than that, you get some great freedom of expression there. C++ is also very expert friendly, as they say it, so there is like a larger threshold to get there. Experts can do a lot with it, they can be very expressive with it, but at the same time, if you're not an expert, things can get hard to understand how things are actually functioning and why they're doing it the way they do it. That's it actually about C++. So what we have is like a costless abstractions which we want to achieve. We still have to do our work ourselves, but C++ definitely gives the tools to do it. And only when you get to the really the expert level, you get more and more of this freedom actually and get further into it. Yes.
So I was wondering,
I think definitely in the past there were quite a lot of myths here. I think I tried to identify the most prominent ones. So most of them they were actually true a few decades ago, and then a lot of C plus C programs. I tried it back then, and they typically say C works, and C++ has all this issue, so I stick with C. And it's only recently with C++ 11 and all the newer standards that they once again are actually focusing on it and then trying to fix those flaws and so on. So if you actually take a look at the popularity of C++ itself, you basically see a similar story. So you see from the 70s that it's getting slightly more popular and popular. But then when we enter the 90s and certainly the 21st century, you see that a lot of those people that actually went from C to C++, they now went to an even higher level language because it suited them better. And so you really see C++ decline again. And then until about 2010, 2011, when the C++ 11 standard came out, then you really see now that C++ is once again getting more popular and more popular. So now the last couple of years, you do see quite a lot of C developers that are actually starting to transition to C++ with their newer applications.
I'm almost convinced. Is there an actual runtime or implementation that we can use microcontrollers? I mean, everything you showed makes sense on embedded Linux, right? But what about going a step further? Like, is there a reference implementation that runs everywhere, FreeRTOS, any real-time operating system, bare metal?
I think you do have the default implementations for most C++ library things that are in there. And then you have a couple of implementations for the libc++ there. So a couple of them are actually aimed at microcontrollers. So there's a UC libc++, for example. It's definitely not as mature. And then there's even this project, Include OS, I believe it's called, where basically you can just link You literally do include OS, and basically you just link with all the functionality it needs. And this library, it really has all the functionality there, for example, to boot the device and also to have the entire runtime there to run on basically any platform.
Yes. When he created Linux, which is now almost 30 years ago, Linus Torvalds deliberately excluded C++ for writing a kernel. C++ hadn't matured very much at that time yet, but he said there were specific architectural reasons. Do you know which ones, what he was talking about?
Yes. So first of all, the reason why a lot of C developers stick to it is actually because of what Linus Torvalds said. A lot of people actually listen to him.
And yeah, without knowing why.
Well, he's a very clever guy. I think he does quite some nice things. But I think if I remember correctly, his most concern with C++ is that when you really want to write an extremely fast and performant kernel, you just need to have direct access to all the lower level superstructures and that kind of things. And so what he basically says is, if you start to abstract them away, you throw away performance.
Is that true? I don't think it's true. Doubting what he said, but you've just proven that if you don't use it, you don't pay for it, and I think that is largely true.
Yes. And also, I've tried to show that there is the possibility for costless abstractions, but at the same time, they're not easy to actually achieve. So you need you really need to engineer it together to get a very nice interface that is as little overhead as possible.
So maybe he meant that's not worth the bother.
It's because it's not made as a system language, right? So it's made as an application language. And the thing is, he was saying about discarding the things you don't use. You can do that when you have an environment of libraries and applications and everything goes together. But on a kernel, it's different because you can't really discard anything. You need to keep everything statically linked because there is no nothing else that's touching that at the linking level, right? It's just an API of symbols that you heard about. But there is no relationship between the system itself.
Yeah.
So probably that might be one of those limits that you're talking about.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's all a matter of performance, because at this point, I would say that, especially with new compilers, there is not that much difference in performance between the two. The bigger problems are still the 10 extra megabytes, because that comes from the runtime. And languages without runtime don't have that. So Rust has a big advantage in embedded, I think, on C++, because it gives the same kind of paradigms. They copy each other, actually, but it doesn't have a garbage collector. And it's not something, So Go is not a system language, because instead of 16 megabytes, you can get Hello World of 26 megabytes, because it's even more bloated.
Yeah. But 3 years from now, that shouldn't be a problem anymore, right? Because the memory keeps on growing all the time. We know that it's
it depends on which target you're talking about. If you're talking about embedded Linux, yes, maybe. But if you're talking about microcontrollers, low power devices, we still have stuff with 16K of RAM.
But I think mostly the point of about C++ was there are, instead of C where you have one way to do things, with C++ you have 20 ways of doing things, and 19 of them are wrong. And the problem is that
if you have
a huge community of people that try to collaborate, and you have all those people trying to write code, and they all have different styles and different approaches, well, it's going to quickly become a mess. While with C, you only have, 30 keywords, something like that. The language is quite simple. So instead of trying to reduce C++ to a small subset that will indeed be C, well, let's just use C because it makes more sense.
Yes, that's also one of his arguments. Now, I think, especially if you see like the evolution of C++, you also see, especially with the type traits and all the compile time things, that you can start to check a lot of things actually that developers are doing. But once again, you really need to know what you're doing, and you cannot do it on several kind of ways. But you actually get much more of the interface to actually express what you really want to do and to actually check that this is used right. But yeah. So I'm not sure it's still that valid, but indeed it's also one of its arguments back then at the day. Yeah.
Well, I agree with the speaker that it's very easy to stuff a C++ program full of tricks and make it extremely expert friendly. And yes, the question is whether you want that in large communities. But on the other hand, yes, if you want to, you can be much more efficient.
Yeah, that's true. Now, I think if you don't use a proper architecture, which is like one level above it, you can also do like the weirdest things and get the weirdest things together. And I think that you can also do it in C actually. But I agree that it's much easier to do actually in C++ because of all the different options you have there.
Well, also, doesn't the higher learning curve and more features of C++ in a way make it more dangerous for embedded software? Where stability of software is really important. Like, personally, I noticed that with C++, you have very nice abstractions, like you move semantics and then you copy semantics and everything. But that, in my opinion, makes it easier to make very subtle bugs, where if you make one mistake in your move constructor, have fun finding that bug, but it'll make your whole program crash after a while, and then it's really not something you can have in C where everything stays simple.
Yeah. Yes, I can see your point. But at the same time, I think in C it's also quite easy to forget something, right? I mean, you typically have these rules you have to follow, and typically they're only in the documentation, so it's also quite easy to forget to initialize something or to delete it or to even know where it is. And then there in C++, thanks to all those abstractions, you can actually make a lot of things also just easier to use, I think. So it really depends a bit on your application, I think, and on what you like most. But yeah, I do agree that some of the things that are in here, they are actually forbidden in certain coding standards, because they're advanced stuff. They say it's too difficult, let's not do it, let's stick with the very simple subset, and
that requires a much bigger mental model to keep the code in mind, and then if you're new to the codes and you get one of those example RAII templates in front of you and you don't know what you're looking at, you're never going to find a bug. While a C code, you can look at basically any C code base and know what you're looking at.
I think in one way that's also true. What I typically also find if you search online actually is that they basically say that all those pointers and so on, if you start using a lot of pointers, that it's also your mental model is much bigger because you need to know all these things, know where they go. And typically they favor return by value, for example, because your mental model there is much smaller. And thanks to C++ 11 with the move semantics, for example, you can actually basically combine the best of both worlds in the sense that you don't copy it, but at the same time you have your return by value semantics again, and then your mental model gets smaller again. So yeah, it really depends, I guess, also on how you use C++ and then what your usage is there.
But then if you forget that equals delete with your copy constructor and somebody else uses your class without knowing everything, it dies again.
Yeah, that's true. I think you can do similar things in C as well, right? If you start copying pointers without really knowing that you shouldn't be copying it because it is something referenced to some resource or something, you can also get into that trap, I think. But I agree, because of the abstraction, you also get affected sometimes. You know not as well what is going on inside the class, and so it's easier to fall into that trap because you don't have to look into the class to really understand what it does.
Yeah, two questions that intrigued me in the presentation. Is there any reason to use this not know template when you can just use reference, which has been around in C++ since forever? And secondly, what do move semantics add to the correct usage of the const keyword? If you label everything const, which is not going to change, normally the compiler should be able to figure out that it can use some copy constructor that only flips around pointers or references without actually physically copying any memory. And that was possible long before C 2011, so why did they add this? I think it's, again, and it's typical for C++, if I may, adding more, you know, like nice candy for experts.
Well, to answer your first question about not know, if you can use reference, definitely go for reference. They're indeed much better, and you also don't have the issue. But there are these cases where you cannot use references. Well, the case I typically have, if I have to interface with C code, or I have like a C interface, then I certainly have to use pointers, and sometimes references are simply not possible. And there I start messing around with pointers, and then I find it quite useful to actually have the GSL not null there. In pure C++ code, you're completely right. I rarely use it, and references are definitely the way to go if you can. The owner on the other end is still quite useful, I think, there, because in C++ you also need to declare ownership, and sometimes if you do want to transfer it, at least it's very clear. And then to answer your second question about the const keyword there. So theoretically, you are definitely right. So the compiler should figure out if it's const, then we can just read it and it's okay. But in practice, the const keyword is mainly something for developers themselves, actually, and to prohibit them from changing. And the reason why most compilers actually don't really trust const is because you can actually cast it away with const cast, which is just bad practice anyway. If people give me a const cast, or any cast for that matter, in their review, they are really going to have a hard time defending it, and they really need to prove that they actually have no other option but to use it. But because of this, the const case is actually not as straightforward as it seems to be. So yeah. So quite often, if you have const with move semantics, it might still copy it if you don't explicitly move it, unless you really don't use it anymore. But yeah, that's up to the compiler.
Actually, I have a question pretty similar to that. There was a keyword that was added quite recently, which is constexp and if constexp in C++ 17. Well, I'm still learning the gist of C++ 17, but you know, I've disassembled quite a lot of code, and I still fail to see the point of that, for example.
ConstExpert is really, as I showed you, compatible programming with templates, like for example the Fibonacci example. And ConstExpert, the original case, is really in there. So it's basically writing compile time code, but much more clearly. So if you have seen ConstExpert code, it's much more easier to read than actually the same template code. I actually wanted to add the ConstExpert case for Fibonacci here, but most compilers are running out of memory during compilation to get to Fibonacci 40 with ConstExpert, while with templates it actually runs in a Vim. So we still have to optimize a lot there. But mainly ConstExpert is a replacement for compile time programming mainly. Although we're still really exploring that area, and at the moment it seems that the guideline is to ConstExpert everything.
Yeah, but that's weird, because to me the compiler should be smart enough to know that it can't compile at compile time anyway. You know, if you're gonna achieve a constant, I expect the compiler to see it.
Yes. And it will actually, well, it depends on the compiler, but it depends on the use case, and in definitely a couple of cases it will. In order to really know when it will do it, when it won't do it, you actually need, once again, a lot of specific knowledge to actually be sure of it. Just to give a stupid novice example, if you, for example, would put your the code actually in a separate translation unit, obviously the compiler cannot optimize it. But it's typically like a newbie trap that they think, but it will get inline because look, I put inline in the header. But if it's in a different translation unit, then you can still not inline the code at all. And I think it's in that direction also that they try with ConstExpert to actually make it more readable and more better. A small difference perhaps between the ConstExpert and the template things is that templates must be fully defined at compile time, otherwise you get a compiler error, while at ConstExpert it's a bit fuzzy because there, as you say, the compiler will determine itself, can it actually do it at compile time? If it can do it at compile time, it will. If it cannot do it at compile time, it will just treat it as a normal runtime function.
Because for example, one of the things that are completely useless in modern compilers is the inline keyword. That thing does nothing anymore.
No, so indeed.
I see it in that direction and I'm like, okay, why did they add that?
Yeah, but I think it's, you should find it more in replacing so templates and compile time programming it to in a much more readable fashion.
I think we'll leave it here. We'll take a short break. Thank you, Bart, for your presentation, and thanks for your questions.